and welcome to the IBHS Research Center. I am Christina Gropp, and I'm joined today by our lead research meteorologist, Dr. Ian Giammanco, and we have some exciting news to share. Ian, yesterday, it was a big day for us.
We do. We have some great news to share from our perspective. We have a new Texas state record hailstone, so largest hailstone documented in the state of Texas.
Everything is bigger in Texas, even the hail, apparently. At 6.416 inches, this hailstone that fell down in Hondo, Texas, back on April 28th, scanned by the IBHS team on May the 6th, yesterday became that record-holding hailstone. Ian, what kind of thunderstorms produces this kind of a hailstone?
So these types of hailstones come from what we call, and I'm going to take this stone from Christina and hold it. You can see how big this one is. It's printed in black material. We've got the United States record hailstone here, the Vivian, South Dakota hailstone right here. But it takes very, very strong upward moving air to actually suspend something, a big hunk of ice that's this big. And the storms that do that are called supercell thunderstorms. These are the big thunderstorms that rotate. They actually produce a lot of our long track, very damaging tornadoes we see across the United States every year. But these storms are also capable of sustaining really, really big hailstones. And this Hondo storm, that's an area west of San Antonio, was no different. It was a supercell thunderstorm. It moved across the area, produced a lot of big hail.
Yes.
And significant straight line winds as well, and caused significant damage in that area west of San Antonio that extended out to Hondo, where this particular hailstone was found.
That's right. And I went down to Hondo, Texas, along with our 3D scanning expert, Ross Maiden, and we talked to the homeowner whose yard this hailstone fell in. And it fell through a tree. So a tree in her front yard broke the fall of this hailstone, which probably helped keep it intact when it hit the ground in her front yard, thankfully not hitting her vehicle or anything. And that's part of why she was able to take it, put it in her freezer, get in touch with the National Weather Service, who got in touch with us, and that started this whole chain.
That's right. The tree actually probably helped slow the stone down. We saw no evidence in the field of the stone fracturing. So it slowed it down, managed to make its way to the ground, and then a very, very savvy homeowner, whom we love those, probably one of us weather nerds, or at least some of her family we knew were weather nerds, she saved it. Contacted the National Weather Service and the process started, and our quick response record hail team got out to the field with our 3D scanner that we used to actually document some of these gargantuan record-setting hailstones.
Ian, these contacts are in place because this isn't the first record hailstone that we've helped document, is it?
That's right. This is our third now. We've actually investigated four total. We had one in Arkansas that didn't quite meet record criteria, but it goes all the way back to the Walter, Alabama event for the Alabama state record. That's the stone Christina's holding up right there. That was our very first quick response, where we were able to get out to the field, scan, get the dimensions of the stone with a high degree of precision, and verify that it was a record. And that's actually in the National Center for Environmental Information, the record books.
Yeah, so now the Hondo stone, our third record, if you hold them up side by side, you can see the Texas record, even bigger than the Alabama record. And the third record that we have at IBHS is the Colorado record that fell, was it 2018? 2019.
The 2019 near Bethune, Colorado.
Colorado. Yep. That's exactly right out there. So we've got three state records now. So Ian, talk to us a little bit about why we 3D scan.
So one of the reasons is to collect these precision digital models. It helps preserve these record-setting hailstones and their unique shapes. As you can see with Christina and I holding up these unique hailstones, they have just a very, very different shape. They're not perfect spheres by any means. This is the Alabama record. As you can see, it's very flat. There's a lot of spikes and knobs and nubs. We want to understand what are the details of these unique shapes, and we've been able to show that as hailstones approach these sizes, they get less spherical. They actually become more oddly shaped. And that actually impacts how fast these things fall. And that in turn means how much energy it has when it hits things, like your house, your car, maybe your air conditioning unit, those kinds of things. So we take that information here at IBHS and look to see how do building materials withstand these kinds of impacts or not.
So let's talk about a process of 3D scanning. We've got the 3D scanner here.
Yep.
We've got on our little stage here the stand that we would put the actual stone in, now the 3D print of it. Talk us through the process.
That's right. So this device, it's handheld. This is a 3D laser scanner. It basically tracks a laser beam across its target. And in our case, it's our Hailstone here. And you see these dots sitting around on this rack. Those are infrared positioning targets. This lets the scanner know its position relative to what it's scanning. And in our case, it's a Hailstone. And Ross Maiden, our engineer here at IBHS, is the world's foremost expert on 3D laser scanning. Ross would tell you he coats the stone with compressed air or duster that you'd use to knock the dust off your laptop keyboard. It helps basically kind of freeze the stone a little bit and provides just enough coating to make sure that laser is tracked evenly across the surface
without changing the size of the hailstone.
That's right. It doesn't do anything to it. In fact, it actually helps preserve it through adding just a little bit more cold air to help keep it from melting so fast. And it just gives it just enough opaque look as it does that to make sure the laser is tracked evenly across the stone. It does not change the properties of the hailstone, doesn't really do anything to it other than help this guy see the surface of the hailstone.
And that allows us to capture these 3D models that give us those precise measurements. 6.416 inches at its largest.
We can extract all sorts of things, the volume, and we weigh these stones, so we get the density, we get everything we want to know about these kind of hailstones. So what we would do, we would point our scanner at our target, we'd depress the trigger, and then we simply just turn the turntable. The scanner knows its position relative to our mount here, and it traces the laser across the surface of this hailstone and produces these really high precision digital models of hail that we can do all sorts of things with. We can evaluate the nuances of the shape. We can 3D print them like you see sitting in front of us. We can even put these things, we can print them to their exact mass. We can go throw these in a vertical wind tunnel and actually look at the real aerodynamics behind these things.
That's part of what we do and why it's worth our time to go out in the field and capture these stones. Ian, talk a little bit about the aerodynamics of these stones.
Yeah, so hailstones themselves, we used to think hailstones kind of gyrated and tumbled in these random different directions, but these gargantuan hailstones, we actually start to see they kind of spin like this. And what we noticed in putting these in a vertical wind tunnel is these lobes, these spikes, actually act like rotors. They actually act like helicopter rotors and generate lift. So we saw the stones actually start to rise in the vertical wind tunnel without any change in that wind speed that's holding them up. You know, 100 plus miles an hour holding this stone up. And we think it gives these stones just enough time in that hail growth region to get to these really, really big sizes.
These stones are just impressive. And I think we should take a look now at Ross Maiden scanning this stone down in Hondo, Texas. Take a look at some of this video from back on May 6th when the team was down there. And we had the opportunity to go into this homeowner's home and document a little piece of weather history.
That's right.
A pretty cool day. And her grandkids were there with us, and I think we might have instilled a little love of science in there to some young minds. But a really exciting day, and we really appreciate homeowners who take the time to save these hailstones.
That's right. There's some methods to the madness of how to preserve these hailstones. So if you think you may have a record-setting hailstone, you see Ross right there. See that glove in his hand. It's important there to use a glove if you're handling stones. Don't handle them too much. I know they're cool. We all love really big, crazy, wicked-shaped hail, and we want to grab it.
And that was what happened when we went down to Arkansas, when we thought we might have a state record there, but by the time we got there, the stone had been handled too much, and we couldn't document the stone at a large enough size to make the state record.
That's right. Unfortunately, it had melted enough to get an accurate picture of the size, so it did not qualify as a record hailstone.
But melting is not the only issue that we run into when we're trying to save these stones.
Yeah, so we thought from this Hondo event, there might have been a bigger hailstone. There were some images that circulated on social media, but unfortunately, the homeowner decided to use this hailstone for the beverage of their choice. We would actually advise not to do that. Hailstones do pick up lots of dust, particulate, all that kind of things that are actually out in the air. They're not just pristine, like distilled water, ice you might produce.
It's different than the ice out of your freezer, both in how it's made and its density and many other ways. So don't eat the hail.
That's right. And they fall on the ground. They're going to pick up dirt and debris and all that good stuff that's laying around your yard.
And that dirt and debris was still on this hailstone when Ross and I saw it.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, the stone, this is going to make a divot, and it's going to indent in the ground if it's preserved well. And you're going to have all that that dirt and kind of material. So we don't advise using hailstones for that, but we'd rather see you guys out there save these potential record hailstones, give the National Weather Service a call, and that can start the process. And we come check and see if you might have a state record.
Absolutely. We really appreciate our partners over at the National Weather Service office in the Austin San Antonio office. They reached out to us, helped us coordinate with the homeowner to get down there and document this hailstone so that we can preserve it forever.
Yeah, that's right. And some of the tips, if you think you might have one of these record hailstones, please check out on our website. We've got a good table.
Needs updating.
That's right. We got to update our Texas state record today. We will get that done. And you can see what hail sizes there might be in your area. But if you think you might have one of these record hailstones, and we're talking, you know, 4 to 5 inch hailstones or bigger. So this Vivian South Dakota U.S. records would be 8 inches in diameter or so. So that's what we're talking about with the U.S. record. But if you think you might encounter one of these hailstones, the thing is, put some gloves on like you saw Ross had. He had a rubber glove on to handle the hailstone. Rubber, leather gloves, that it's a great way to avoid a lot of the melting that could come if you're touching it with just your bare hands.
Your hands are warm, so you want to keep your hand off of the stone directly.
Yeah, don't handle it that much. And then place it just in a Ziploc bag. Ziploc freezer bag, try to squeeze or suck the air out of it. That can actually help minimize how much sublimation happens. Now, we'll talk about sublimation. We're going to get a little science lesson here today. So sublimation is the process where a solid goes straight from that form to a gas. Mm-hmm. So for those of us like myself who live in the South, we often throw snowballs in the freezer when it snows every 50 years here.
Gotta save that snow.
That's right. We gotta save that snow in case it never happens again. And those snowballs sublime, they get smaller with time. Well, hailstones do the exact same thing. And we want to make sure we can minimize that process so someone can get out and inspect your hailstone to see if it's a record. Our IBHS quick response team can get out there with the National Weather Service. So put it in a freezer bag, try to suck all the air, squeeze all the air out of that freezer bag, seal it up, put it in your freezer, and try not to handle it too much. We know they're cool. We know you want to look at it, but do your best to get it into the freezer as quickly and safely as you can. And then contact your local office of the National Weather Service or your favorite broadcast meteorologist. Mm-hmm. They'll know who to get in touch with. They can point you to the National Weather Service, or they can even help facilitate the process. And it's a really cool story. And then the communication chain does its thing. You know, folks reach out to us here at IBHS, and off our quick response team comes if our homeowners are willing and able to do so.
Yeah, and that sublimation process is also why the 3D prints are so useful to us, because even if we wanted to, we can't keep these stones forever.
That's right. Ultimately, we can't save these stones. Mm-hmm. There really isn't a method to do that. We can put them in cold storage, store them in dry ice. That helps preserve them for quite a while. But ultimately, we will lose them, and they will lose their details and shapes. So we want to capture those fine details, and that's one of the reasons why we do this 3D scanning work, is to preserve these very unique hailstones for future scientists to study, future wind tunnel testing, and ultimately, like we do here at IBHS, take that into the application space and turn it into something that can help with testing of building materials.
Absolutely, Ian. That brings us to a great point of what we do with some of this research here at IBHS. From all the data collected by the IBHS Hail Field Study team, along with our 3D scans, it's informed a really important new test protocol that's helping people reduce the hassle of hail damage.
That's right. If you are tired of replacing your roof from hail damage, please check out our hail impact shingle ratings.
IBHS.org/impact ratings.
That's right. And all this science that we've done in the field and in the lab got put into that test. The way we conduct the test, the way we manufacture laboratory hailstones here that mimic how real hailstones attack your roof. Not only in their kind of flavor, the strength, the way they hit shingles, the way they attack the roof, and then we score those products using an objective rating system. This isn't a pass-fail. This is actually a number score. And you can see those good and excellent performers. And we test 1.5 to 2 inches. 2 inches is what you'll see on the scorecard. And that accounts for a large number of the hailstorms we see across the U.S.
Most hailstorms do not produce this.
That's right. That's right. This is a rare event. These records, although we've had a few records now over the past couple years, these don't happen in everyday, you know, the supercells all the time. But we do see a lot of big hail. What I'm talking about is 2-inch hail. 1.5, 2 inch, that's well over the severe criteria of 1 inch. We know there are products you can put on your roof that can actually help reduce that damage, stop that nuisance, and get this under control. This is, hail damage, people don't realize it. In any given year, it's somewhere between 60 and 80% of the damage that comes from severe thunderstorms every single year here in the United States.
That is just crazy, Ian. And it's so wasteful to keep ripping roofs off and throwing them in the landfill year after year every time we see
That's
one of
right.
these hailstorms.
You know, we have friends in kind of Hail Alley, Dallas, Oklahoma. My sister lives out there. And you know, some people want, you know, third roof in 10 years.
Yeah.
We need to stop that cycle. And we know, we've seen the pictures from those of you in Dallas putting pool noodles and all sorts of foam all over your cars. I know you're tired of dealing with this hassle. There are ways, if you're tired of dealing with the roofing problem, check out those good and excellent performers. You can get a good product. A lot of places, the cost increase is minimal. It's not much. And talk to your insurance agent. Yeah. You might get yourself a discount on your homeowner's policy.
And while you're at it, while you're putting on those good or excellent rated impact-resistant shingles, you should go all the way to Fortified to protect against the water as well. Ian, talk a little bit about that.
That's right. So re-roofing is the best time to retrofit your roof to get a better, stronger roof. I say bigger. We're not changing doing an addition to your house. But we're talking about a better, stronger roof. And when you're re-roofing is the perfect time to do that. And please check out fortifiedhome.org. This gets you an enhanced nailing pattern that helps reduce the chances of that roof deck coming off. Say you get impacted by a tornado mm-hmm. event, a derecho, severe straight line winds, and you have some damage. This can help keep that roof decking intact. There's some edge details that help keep your shingles down. The edges of shingles are where the wind damage cascade can start. That's where the shingles can get pried up, as well as the good and excellent rated products for hail performance. So it's a great time if you are ready to take that next step.
So many people ask, what could I have done before the storm? This is what you can do. As much fun as we have talking about 3D printed hailstones and state records, it's really all about making our homes better prepared to face the next storm.
That's right. And even if you look at some of the homeowners that have 4 to 5 roofs that experienced Hurricane Sally, mm-hmm. they were able to help their neighbors because they had no damage. And that's what we want to see across the United States when it comes to severe weather. Ultimately, we're going to make this stuff like a bump in the road. Talk to some of those people in Alabama. They have great stories about how they were able to basically help their neighbors who did have damage because their home was in really good shape. No damage, no disruption, no displacement.
Whether it's on the coast with a hurricane or inland with a hailstorm like the one in Hondo, we're working towards those solutions that will narrow the path of damage and help us help homeowners. A really cool story in our third state record. Ian, how excited are you?
Three records. When we went at, you know, trying to pioneer this technology, we knew we were collecting information on hailstones, the characteristics that we had to put mm-hmm. into our laboratory test. And to see it go this far, now we're out there in these state record stones. We're able to scan these things. The scanner also went to Argentina for a really big international project on severe weather down there, that they get just mammoth thunderstorms that also produce these kind of gargantuan hailstones. I never really thought that this would go this way, but you think about how 3D scanning, printing, these kind of new technologies are starting to creep into our day-to-day lives. Well, we just took it, applied it to hail. And we do all sorts of things here with 3D printing and scanning, but this is one of our really cool applications. This system goes to the field with us each year.
So much of this system happens in the back of a minivan on the back roads of the plains.
That's right. We're out there scanning, even doing crush tests of hail, seeing how much force it takes to fracture these things. And how do we replicate that in the lab? And how do we apply that in the way we test building materials?
It all comes together here at the IBHS Research Center. We've really elevated hail and brought that research to life. And now we've got the cool milestones, like our third state record.
That's right. The financial impact of this particular peril is tremendous, and that was our goal. I used to joke, and I'm going to date myself here. I called hail, it was like the no respect tour, a little bit of Rodney Dangerfield. There's no getting respect. Well, I think, hey, that's kind of changing. We see the financial impact year after year and the nuisance and the annoyance that hailstorms bring to our lives. And it's we've created that awareness around this peril. Now we're starting to see, one, the shingle manufacturers do their part with these good and excellent performing products. We're starting to break that cycle, and we want to see it continue. That's what we do here at IBHS.
Absolutely. A little bit of cool science on a Friday to show off the Texas state record hailstone from Hondo, Texas, April 28th of this year, 6.41 inches. Ian, it was a big one.
Yes, new Texas state record right there. What a great experience. And again, if you think you have a record hailstone, do your best, save it, preserve it, contact your local office of the National Weather Service or your favorite broadcast meteorologist.
Yes, and as always, follow us on social media, Insurance Institute for Business and Home Safety here on Facebook. You can follow us at Disaster Safety over on Instagram and Twitter and see all of the cool science work that's happening here as we work to narrow the impact of all of these natural disasters on our lives. Again, ibhs.org/impact ratings. That's where you'll find those shingle performance ratings. And we hope you had a little bit of fun, learned a little something about hail and some science here on a Friday with us. Thanks so much.